Balsamiq. It's PICCIA here. I am a design professional, have been about 30 years in the industry. These days, I concentrate on user experience and also accessibility. In this series of videos, I am talking to you about the process that I am following and creating to rebuild this website, which is the website for a great museum in central Italy, in the city of Perugia in Umbria. This is the current site and we're rebuilding it. So we went through, in our conversations, we went through the research with the user personas that you had here and the competitive analysis in the first video. Then in the third video, we talked about sitemaps. And now I am going to show you how we went from the site mapping to starting work on the wireframes, the ideation of the initial wireframes. Now, my thinking was to start from the static pages first, because those are the ones that are easier to template and they can help us also start building a visual library, a library of items. However, the design team told me that they would prefer to start from the homepage because that's how their process works. And it's very important in a project. There is no right or wrong way. We're all working together. So I said, by all means, let's start from the homepage. And that's a very good idea, in fact. In a lot of projects, I will start from the homepage. The important thing is to remember that when you build a homepage, that's really the page where people go to work out where to go next. It's by no means, in fact, often it's not the most important page on a website. It just has to be the clearest and to communicate the brand as best as possible. So we wanted to reflect the vibrancy of the museum, which offers loads of different events. So we decided to have a grid of images here, one for the current exhibition, one for a featured event. What's on today is very important. If you're building a visit, then explore the collection and support us. This was a hypothesis. Now, my first comment was that, of course, on the homepage, you can't respond to the needs of every single user persona at once. You probably do with something like this, but sometimes when you are responding to everybody, you're not responding to anybody. We have 6 user personas in this project. So what I suggested was, why don't we make sure that we think about right now about a space in between the navigation and the rest of the page where we have room for a possible call to action. Another thing that I noticed in the original page is that there's a logo here, but the logo, if you haven't seen it before, doesn't tell you the name of the gallery. So I thought, well, what about the user that lands on the page and has no idea who we are? In this version, it's spelled out, Galleria Nazionale dell'Umbria. Then here, a call to action. So maybe there's new research that they need to find out about, but it could be for a concert that they want for people to book because maybe it's tonight. And here a paragraph on their mission, because the previous site told nothing to the visitor. So this is what I thought we should do. And now I'm happy because now I'm able to build a user journey from here. And also down here, it makes sense for me that something for everybody. And if I come here, I'm not really sure what to do, I have a good choice of things that I can do. You can do wireframes in many ways. Some people, or for some project, I've done wireframes that are incredibly detailed and they're specific to the pixel because that's the way that it needs to be done. And that happens especially with websites that already exist. In this case, we're redesigning. So our wireframes are very loose. They're just about layout. Now, the other page that we went to, I'm going to take you back to the sitemap, which is my best friend, is the about page. We decided to start from the about page because we felt that it could give the visual style and the content style for the other pages. It's a static page. We have extremely dynamic pages and we have static pages. And we wanted to go through the static pages first because that would allow us to then create a few visual styles and then deal with the really complicated pages that are the dynamic ones. So this is what the intro is going to be. And this is a template that we're going to have on most pages. But then at this point, so big paragraph that introduces things. And then because the page goes on, we need to have some element that lets you know that there is something more to see, and which is called progressive disclosure. And you go down and there is more, and it's probably going to follow a more traditional layout with just an image and here the history and so on. But the important thing is that content-wise, we're telling them what we do for them, not simply talking about our features. Benefits first. So one thing that we started considering now was the navigation. Now, the navigation tells you where you are, but it also helps you understand a website. So because of our user personas, we knew that we didn't want a very complicated navigation. One other thing that we know is that for now, we don't have that many main pages, so the level is not too broad. But we also do know that this is only the first version of this site. We know that we're going to add things. There's going to be a newsletter that's going to live on its own page. There's going to be a blog for sure. We may even have a separate news section. So we know that there will be other things that will be added. Therefore, it's quite risky to have a menu the way you see it here, because it may be that we come to have so many main pages that there's simply no room for them. Now, I am a very, very strong proponent of always having the navigation visible on the page. So when you scroll down, the navigation is sticky, the header is sticky, and you still know which site you're on and what the pages are and the current page highlighted and so on. However, that's why it's so important to talk about two developers and designers in the same room. It was actually a developer that brought this issue up, that we don't know in the next version how many pages we will add. I am not a big fan of hamburger menus on a desktop site, but they persuaded me with provisos. So basically they said, if we have a hamburger menu, we're also going a little bit away from the first version of the site, and the director is going to be happier that we've worked on creating a different solution. You can code it properly so that it's accessible and it's also SEO friendly, and that's where the developer comes in really handy. But my point about always being able to know where you are, it comes also from this book by Steve Krug called Don't Make Me Think. If you read one book about web design, make it that one. And he has this story that I love, which is, imagine that you're being bundled in the trunk of a car and then you're being let out and your blindfold is taken off. Where are you? You need to know immediately. There needs to be a street sign telling you where you are and another sign telling you which city you're in and so on. And the same thing needs to happen wherever you are on a site. If you land on any page from anywhere, you need to have all indicators that tell you where you are. So this is what we thought we'd do. You have the hamburger menu, which when opened up covers the whole page because the director is going to like it, but very easy to close. So don't worry, it won't be annoying. It will be accessible and usable and SEO friendly, like I said. And then we use breadcrumbs. We use a breadcrumb that tells you where you are in the main site architecture and where you are on the page, because we will have internal links on the page. So I find this satisfies me. It makes everybody happy. And I agree that we want to go a little bit further away from the original design. So navigation is such an important part of your website. Do give it enough time. Start from the site mapping. Watch Donna Spencer's course in this in the academy, in the Balsamiq Academy, and think about it properly and make sure that your pages, wherever people are, help people find their way around. Then the other thing that we looked at was one of the fundamental knots of this project, which is the events. And we have a few alternate ones. As you can see, we've had a few iterations on how we present this, because we are going to have many types of events. There's going to be exhibitions that are along a certain period of time. There's going to be book launches. There's going to be concerts. There's going to be guided visits. Those are also events. So we started thinking, shall we have a yesterday and tomorrow? Shall we have a what's on today? Shall we have a current exhibition? Shall we have a calendar? And then starting to look at a lot of other sites to see what worked, what didn't work. And then we decided that we're going to do something like this. This is going to be quite nice and big. And then, of course, the tagging, so that people can simply see the clusters of events that they're interested in together. If you're only interested in music, you want to see what they're doing with music, you can click on this and it will show up here. And of course, you can look also by day. So we are going to have to consider and think about various different views that we need. So there has to be an archive, or a view rather than an archive, of all the music events together, current and in the future, and then an archive of all the music events in the past. And the same applies to every type of event that we're working on. And in fact, here is an instance of mostre, means exhibitions. So current exhibition one and current exhibition two, because the museum has more sometimes. And then prossimamente means coming next. And here you have an archive of the exhibitions and future exhibitions. This, we're going into the individual events, and we're going to keep them quite simple. So here you have the titles, you have the date and a description and any related events, or any type of element. But I just want to tell you that there is one wireframe that we're doing a lot of work on, and it's still a work in progress, and that is the wireframe of the individual work. Now, here's the collection. The collection is all the works that live in the museum all the time. So on the homepage of the collection, here we have the masterpieces, here we have explore the collection, featured work, and search. However, the main issues, so the first thing is the image, which will have all sorts of sorceries and things that you can do to it in our second phase. And then below, you need all the technical details, where it is, the title, the author, the year, and the technique, you know, the medium, and so on. And then a description. It's being rewritten by our UX writer, because we need for the description to be appealing to users of all types. But what we need to do also is create a link to the in-depth version of this description, because we also need to serve the scholars who are here, because they need the scientific research. So I'll keep you posted. We're still on this. But what I will talk to you about in the next video is how I build user flows, because it's all well and good to build wireframes and make sure that we design, that we insert all the content that we need in each individual page. I feel that in order to make a site really lively and a dynamic experience that reflect the experience in real life, is to create user journeys. To first of all, make sure that the existing journeys that we have created in the sitemap actually make sense. And that also from here, I am creating specific itineraries that can be based on a featured event. That can be, for instance, how many hours have you got? Have you only got 3 hours today? Okay, this is the itinerary that you can take. Or, for instance, as I've said before, all the works that have flowers in them, you know, a botanical itinerary. So there is a lot to do, but one thing that I find Balsamiq so useful for is the creation of user flows. And the sitemap feature is something that I love using to create initial flows, and then I could go into more detail with wireframes for them. Thank you so much. See you in the next video. Bye.